introduce our program this morning, as soon as I remember what the title of it is. So we're going to be hearing about how to set up and facilitate a support group. And we'll be hearing about that from, I think, probably the world's two most authoritative experts on the subject. They've been doing it for 30 years. And they are Lorna and Bill Goldberg. And I'm going to just quickly remind you, some of you may not know them or maybe you've heard this 10 years running, but Lorna is a psychoanalyst in private practice. That's her theme song. Lorna practices with children, adolescents, and adults. She's co-led the support group with Bill for 30 years. She's on the board of directors of ICSA, and she's the dean of faculty at the Institute for Psychoanalytic Studies in Teaneck, New Jersey. She's written many articles, many in the ICSA publications. And Bill is also a psychotherapist in private practice. He is the director of training and education for the Rockland County Department of Mental Health. Rockland County is my hometown, and we need a lot of mental health there. And Mr. Goldberg is also an adjunct instructor in the social work department of the Dominican College in Rockland County. So please welcome Lorna and Bill.
This is going to be somewhat informal and extemporaneous, which is the way we say that we really underprepared. we want to talk to you about our group, the history of the group, how we run it, what our policies are, and make some recommendations for how you are, if you're interested in starting a group, how you do that. And let me just start with a brief reminder of the importance of groups. We consider groups to be the primary source of help for former cult members, often. Sometimes it's not primary, but very important. But for many former cultists, it is primary. We are all members of groups. We define ourselves in terms of the groups that we identify with. Groups are very powerful. Every cult member was harmed by a group. By definition, even those that were involved in a one-on-one situation, in that case, the group was a dyad. But groups are part of our lives from almost the moment we're born. The first sign of personhood in the infant is the social smile. And that's what, as all of us who are parents know, that's what filled us with the joy when the child first recognized us and smiled at us. And even a hermit, should there be, I guess there's hermits nowadays, defines himself or herself in terms of groups they came from. You can't work with somebody unless you know where they came from, where their roots are. And that's why groups are so important. So Lorna's going to talk a bit about the history of our
group. How it all started. It actually started with my brother entering the Unification Church. But for many years, our family didn't know he was actually in the Unification Church because there was another name that it was called at the time. And in trying to understand how my brother had come to change so dramatically, my family contacted a lot of people who there wasn't a formal network at that point. There wasn't anything known about cults. People didn't even use the word very much then. And most of the help came from young people who had come out of that group, like Chris Edwards and Paul Engel. And in talking to them and their families, and another person that we met along the way was Jack Clark, and he was very important and very significant to us in helping us figure out how to handle this situation. But we decided to rescue my brother out of the group, and he left in 1976. He's gone on with his life, and he's doing very nicely now. But through that process, we were really helped a lot by people, and we were both social workers. It was suggested to us by a parent whose son had been involved in the same group that maybe since we were social workers, we should start a group like Margaret Singer's group. There was one group at that point in the States, and that was in Berkeley. Margaret had talked about it. And so in 1976, we started our group. At this point, you know, we're really going to tell you how we learned from all the mistakes we made in the beginning of the group 32 years ago as two young social workers just trying to figure things out. We started with the group having the group at different people's homes. And we would have a monthly group, and every month it was at someone else's group home. And since it was an open-ended group and people could come or not come, you can imagine the whole situation got very confusing, right, Bill?
Because people didn't know where the next group meeting was unless they had attended the first one, if they called us. So it was
pretty chaotic in the beginning. So we, after stumbling around a few months, we decided that it would make sense to hold every group meeting at our home from 7:30 for about 2 hours of the formal meeting. People would come in around 7:15, have maybe some coffee and a dessert, and then we'd sit down and we'd have the meeting for about 2 hours or so.
Let me mention that what happens before and after the group is just as important as the group itself. So we build that in. The informal schmoozing, the drinking a cup of coffee, introducing yourself, is
can
just...
Can you translate schmoozing for the...
Oh, come on, then.
Is that
what
it's when two people get together and just yenta.
Two yentas
get together. So we consider what happens before the group just as important as the group itself, and what happens after. And there's many times when we say, okay, the group's over, we'll see you next month. We give them a schedule. Every September I make a schedule for the following year, so that no matter when they come during the year, they know at least 1 year ahead. And people, of course, can call us and ask us when the next meeting is. Anyway, at the end of the meeting, we say, okay, you know, have a good month. We give out the schedule for the next several months. And then Lorna and I clean up, and Lorna goes to bed, and I'm taking out the garbage, and there's still people around the front of the house just saying and talking, which is wonderful. That's just what we want. Not when we want to go to bed in our house.
After a while.
Do it out on the porch, but that's fun.
We try to get everyone out. But in the early years, most of the people who were attending the group had come out as a result of deprogramming. They were in high-intensity groups. They were young people for the most part. They ranged in age maybe from 19. 30 would be an old person in the group at that point. And we were young ourselves. So it was a young person's group. And so there were certain things that we saw early on that was related to the fact that they were rescued out in this way. Had come back home, a lot of them, to their families, and they were struggling with issues of separation. A lot of them, when they came, they were really showing a lot of the marks still of the groups that they had come from. So some of them had come from more of an Eastern meditation type group, some from a Korean religious type Christian group, some of them from more of a self-help type of group. They would show those kind of very different personalities early on. And they would be struggling, you know, to deal with the situation of coming back into their families, and a lot of resentment and mixed feelings, good feelings, bad feelings, conflicted feelings about what had gone on as a result of this process. And a lot, the group became a place that they could really freely talk out those feelings.
And we set up the group for the purpose, we established the policies in the group of people being able to speak freely and not having right or wrong answers, that the purpose of the group is to learn from each other. Often, especially in the beginning, sometimes now, people would come, the ex-cultists, and they'd bring a notebook, and they're ready for us to give them this wisdom, because that's what they had learned, that's what a group was in their cults. So we said, you know, you're free to take notes if you want. We, of course, in the beginning of the group, discussed confidentiality, of course. But if somebody wants to take notes, they can. But we said, you know, this is really more of a process rather than we're not going to be telling you words of wisdom. You're here to learn from each other. And that's the purpose of the group. And that's our role as leaders, is to get the group talking to each other. We don't make pronouncements. And if somebody says, I'm struggling with this particular issue, Lorna and I don't say, why don't you try this? Our role is to say, well, some of the rest of you have had struggles with that. How have you dealt with it?
Yeah, so always pushing it back onto the group and encouraging the group members to help one another. So we have more of a facilitator role than a leader role. And the other thing that we really wanted to, I mean, it just happened because of our personalities, is foster, you know, different points of view. And there are, you know, there are times Bill and I don't always agree on things, and we might see things differently. And the idea that people in the group might see things differently is very important, and that's kind of underlined as part of the group, getting different ways of seeing things, because there was so much unanimity of thought in the groups that they came from. So it was very exciting in the early years when people came to the group to see them as they came back into the world outside the cult, kind of losing that superimposed cult identity and really becoming more of who they were. The group was set up in a way that it was open-ended. People could attend as many groups as they wanted to. They didn't have to make a commitment to come every month. We felt initially that that would be an important thing to do, because they had come out of groups where they had to make more and more of a commitment. So what we saw typically is that someone might come to two or three meetings, they would not come for a while, and then when an issue came up in their lives, that would bring them back. Or another reason they would come back is that they would bring someone who'd come out of their group, you know, to come with them and, you know, talk things out in the group. So maybe we, you know, that points to how people came to our group, how the kind of network we had in the early years. And, there wasn't an internet then. It was more word by, you know, word by mouth, the referrals, we could say. And
we start the group by first reminding people that this is a group for former cult members. And the purpose of the group is to talk about the experience of being a former cult member. We're not here, and this is learning by trial and error, we're not here to take a political stand. We're not here to determine when we're going to picket. We're not here to write letters to the editor, all of which are fine activities. We're not at all opposed to any of those activities. That's not the purpose of this group. And we found that we'd get off the track if we got into some of these other more formalized activist activities. The purpose of the group is to talk about what it's like to be a former cultist. And that's what makes our group a bit more unique, our group and the groups that some of you are running, a bit more unique than some of the other ex-cultist groups. So the way we begin is by first stating the contract of the group, a former cultist. We're here to talk about the experience of being a former cult member. Everything that's said in the group is confidential. And we found that the next step would be to, that was helpful, was to go around the room and everyone introduce themselves, say what group they're from, how long they're out, what their name is, obviously, and any issues that are on their mind this month. Now that's, and we'd go around the room. We found that that helped to break the ice for people, some that were more shy than others, and when we just said, okay, here's the group, go ahead and begin. People, each group is different. It's not an ongoing group therapy where you have the same folks coming back month after month. So since each group is different, you have to kind of begin again by people being willing to speak. So we found it helpful to go around the room and break the ice in that way. And by asking them what's on your mind this month, it has them thinking in terms of issues. After they go around the room, almost always somebody says, well, you know, the same thing happened to me, or I've been struggling with that too, and I don't know how to deal with that. And if that doesn't happen, which is rare, but if that doesn't happen, then one of us will say, well, so-and-so, you raised the issue of this, and, you know, again, I wonder if anyone else has had that experience. Now, other former member groups, I know, do it more formally. What they do is they have a topic. This is today's topic, and they go around the room, and each person comments on that topic. That's okay. There's value in that. It's not our style. We want to have more of an interaction, and we want to use the group as the healing entity more. But other groups, you know, do it in that way, and that's perfectly legitimate.
There's another reason that we do that. When people come to our group for the first time, they're typically terrified, you know? I mean, it's, first of all, you're coming to a group after being in a group, so it allows people to figure out who all these people are, or at least get a sense of who all these people are at the beginning of the group. And that, you know, is very important. Because there is concern, who, you know, are there any plans? I mean, who is going to be here tonight? Can I really trust opening up and talking with them?
I can't tell you how many times people have said to me, after coming to the first group, I thought the other people would be weird. No matter, even people, who is more knowledgeable on the unweirdness of cult members than a former cultist, but we're all products of our society. We're all products of our prejudices. And people feel, yes, my group was, you know, regular people who just got caught up like a leaf in a stream by those other people. And it's so relieving for them to find out that this is all the other experience, that everyone had the same experience, but there were different words for it. The cast of characters was different. The words were different, but the consequences of dissension were disastrous. The pressure that was used, the way the cult leader took advantage of the positive qualities of the cult members, they were always the same. Whether it's a political group, a religious group, a one-on-one, a science fiction group, a therapy group, their experiences were the same. I also want to comment on the screening process
now. Yeah,
I
was going to.
Yeah. In the early days of the group, when it was open-ended, we allowed anyone to come in that was a former member. We had some people come in who had just left the group or had been kicked out of their group. And when we would start to discuss what happened in the cults, they would say, "Well, that didn't happen to me. My group was great." They were feeling guilty. I mean, usually people that are kicked out feel inadequate, guilty, that it was their fault that they got kicked out, that there was something they weren't able to do. And the group then would form a kind of exit counseling session and help the person to see what mind control is and how they were manipulated, which was good and helpful. And that's why the individual made the provocative statement. They were looking for that kind of feedback. But it's not the purpose of our group. It's a good, helpful, important function, but that's not the purpose of our group. So we instituted, several months into the group, a screening process. And everyone that comes to our group now has to meet with us beforehand. And they're screened, and we try our best. First of all,
before you explain I just want to, you know, so much time then, what we would get into when people came out and they hadn't really gotten a sense of the mind control or the dynamics of the group, and they came to our group, they would make statements, and then we would get into a situation where other people in the group were trying to convince them that, you know, that this is a cult and this is why, and we really did not want that to be the focus of our group, as Bill explained. We wanted the focus of the group to be to deal with, once you're out of your group, how do you reacclimate to the world outside? As simple as that, not how to convince somebody to get out of a cult. So therefore, we decided on the screening or the assessment process.
And it's important to keep the focus of the group, we feel, on the healing process of being with other former cult members. Again, because that's a unique situation, it's unique help that we can give in a support group. So in the screening process, there's several purposes of it. One is to get a sense of the individual and to make recommendations. For some people, one-on-one therapy is more helpful. For others, it can be the group. For some, it's a combination. For others, there's other things that are helpful. Wellspring, going to a rehab center. And for a few people, there have been very, very few over the 32 years we've had the group. But for a few people, we say, the group really isn't for you. I can't invite you to the group because I don't think it would be helpful to you, and I don't think it would be helpful to others. But that again, is rare. So the first thing is to get a sense of the individual and then to offer, suggest to them the best place they can get the help. Second reason is to give them a sense of what happens in the group. Lorna and I wrote an article, it's kind of dated now, but in 1982, in Social Work, called Group Work with Former Cultists. And we give them a copy of that, and that gives them a sense of what happens in the group. And the third is to screen, because we've been infiltrated. Even with the screening, we've been infiltrated by present cult members, and obviously they're not bound by confidentiality. They have a very different purpose in coming to the group. And so we try as much as possible. I mean, sometimes we catch them, sometimes we don't. We try as much as possible to weed out people that we think are using the group for different purposes and not permit them to come in. I want to tell you very quickly about one individual who came to our group who used to always come with an athletic bag that he put down. And one day I got a call from him, and he said, "I've got to meet with you." This was on a Thursday night. "I've got to meet with you tonight." I said, "Okay, sure." He came to my house and he said, "I was a member of a cult. I have just left. I want you to know that I was sent to infiltrate your group to get information on you. My athletic bag contained a camera that I was recording your group. My pen, you showed me, with a microphone." He said, and there was nothing you guys said. I mean, we don't in our group, those of you that know us, we're not fire breathing people. We don't rail against groups, and we don't tell people what to do, and we don't insist that deprogramming is vital or something like that. And that's what they expect. They had the stereotype that the cult had in us was that that's what we did, that we'd kidnap everyone and get them out. So he said that actually coming to our group was helpful in helping him to see that there's some other reasons for people to leave groups, some benign reasons. Anyway, just as an aside, I called Herb Rosedale that night, who was the head of the American Family Foundation, the predecessor of ICSA, and I said, "Herb, this young man has left the group. He was very high up in it. I said, he's really got to meet with you because he's got a lot of information that he's frightened about the fact that he knows." And Herb said, "Have him come to my office on Monday." And I said, "Herb, you don't understand. He's very frightened." And Herb said, "Have him come to my office 9:00 tomorrow morning." And that's my memory of Herb. Yeah. That was Herb. So one of the things that we recommend for a group, including a peer-led group, is that you screen individuals coming in. That you, if you don't feel comfortable doing it yourself, hire a professional to do it. Or if somebody feels comfortable, meet with the people beforehand, get a sense of them. We acknowledge the fact that we are imperfect people, and some have slipped through for us, but at least we help.
What sort of questions do you ask in the screening? How do you lead that?
Obviously, we ask them to tell us their story, and I ask them how they feel about coming out of the cult now. What are their issues that they're struggling with now? What do they hope to gain from coming to a group or from entering into therapy? What I'd expect to hear is, "I've got some struggles. There were some good things I got from," or what I expect to hear, what I usually hear. "There were some good things I got from the group, but overall it was certainly far outweighed by the negatives." People that are too glib that say, "Well, I read an article and it said, yeah, that's right, I'm getting out of this." My antenna goes up when I hear things like that. People that went from total agreement with the group to total disagreement with the group overnight, I get very wary of that. Somebody that comes into me, the immediate red flag, and this has happened several times, is they come into me and say, "Well, I'm out, but my sister's still in, and I want you to help me to kidnap her. Can you give me the name of somebody that will kidnap my sister?" And I say, "I'm not falling for that. I'm sorry. Get the hell out of my house." As time goes on, you hear stories. There's a general sense of how people are when they first met. Now, I should mention, that the examples that I gave here of the ambivalence people have, when that's what happens when they first come out. Lorna hasn't gotten to, because I haven't let her get to the part yet, where nowadays we get people that have been out for 10 or 12 years coming to the group.
It's
a very different picture. What I was telling you is when they first come out. Nowadays, people that have been out a longer period of time in general have worked through these issues slowly and painfully on their own and generally have a better sense. But what we try to do then is to clarify, give them words that can help, put into categories what's going on that can help them just to kind of sort it through.
Use the lifting model?
We usually use lifting, although we use Singer's model too.
And
mind control. Yanya's, sure. And that's, of course, a very important thing we do.
Recommend
also, we give them
books.
Articles and books and the like.
I had a comment about the screening process. I was in a support group led by a counselor for former cult members, and there were a couple of people who came into the support group, and they were definitely former cult members, but it seemed like their attitudes were really destructive to the group. One person had just come out of his cult, really didn't know about mind control. He had been betrayed by the leaders. And he said, well, it's still a good group, and it's still a good system. And, it was just, there were a couple of criminals in it who spoiled it for everybody. And he hated our attitudes. He thought
right.
that because we were critical of our groups, we were cynical, and we'd
right.
lost our idealism. And he was very critical of us. He got really angry at us and started criticizing us and then walked out. And the rest of us were just like, who let this guy in here?
Well, that's what led to the screening process, because in the early years of our group, we had that going on, a few times. And we really learned that for the protection of the group and the protection of our mission with the group, maybe that's not the greatest word, mission, but the goal of our group was, or the focus was, to give people tools and through support with each other how to deal with being out of the group, not to challenge each other to come out. And that kind of person would not come into the group unless they had worked these things through.
And we would offer, if I were screening a person like that, I'd say, I'd be happy to meet with you for a few times and talk about these issues. And let's discuss, not to confront, not to argue, but to help you to process what happened to you. Because that's a defensive position that they're taking. But not the group, you're not ready for the group at this point.
You're just yeah.
The other thing that we should mention is that every group should have a leader, even a peer support group, because you need to have somebody that can say, "Okay, we've heard from you, and thank you for your help. Let's turn to some of the other group members now and get your point of view." You've got to have somebody that's a little more equal than the others, who can. I am an Orwellian. to move the group along in case somebody's dominating, because even all groups can have somebody that dominates. And now for us, we're automatically the leaders because Lorna and I organize the group and we're social workers. If there's somebody that's willing to take that role on in a peer-led group, that's good. If it rotates around, that's good. But there should be a leader. And if there's no one that's really willing or comfortable in doing that, I'd suggest you hire somebody.
And if you're not happy with them, fire them.
Right.
In almost every group, there's one person that dominates the whole conversation. Just exactly what do you say? Look, this is for us to share, and we have to share the time. Is that appropriate?
The first thing that I would say is, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Let's hear from some other people. Let's hear what they have to say. If they don't take the hint from that, then I'd say, you've made some really good contributions. I really appreciate it. We really need to hear from some other people. And if they don't take the hint from that, there have been a couple occasions in our group when, after the group, you've said to somebody, you really can't come back. I'm sorry. I'd be happy to meet with you individually, but you know, you're very strong in your opinions. You come across very strong, and that might be helpful to you, but it's not helpful to the other people. But that usually does. Usually, by our just saying, let's hear from some others and how the rest of you react to that. Usually, people get the hint because they usually don't mean to dominate. They just it's got to pour out.
People just have to be noticed.
And that again is well, okay. I would say that they have so much in them like a volcano. And I would refer them for individual therapy.
But there could be different types of people that would dominate.
You know,
some that just need to have, you know, be on stage and have the show, and others that are so caught up emotionally at the moment that they need some time. But as you know, in the group, when you're sitting with people, you can get a sense of what the deal is with this person talking, you know, like they are. And, you know, we are respectful if people come for the first time and they're going through a highly emotional experience and they're pouring it out with the group. We wouldn't cut off that kind of a situation, but we'd also, you know, say to the person, I think, you know, people in the group might have good suggestions on how you can deal with it. You know, part of the role of the leader is to limit, you know, when people are trying to dominate and amplify those who are reluctant to talk. Now, certainly some people, we have to respect that some people are not going to want to talk and we're not going to bully anyone into talking. Certainly going around the room is a good icebreaker for people in the beginning. But some people might just say a few things and you might, you know, want them, you know, could you tell us a little more about it? You know, really help them come out of it. So, you know, that's a part of the...
You're an orchestra leader as a group leader.
Yeah.
And sometimes you want to tamp down the brass a little bit, and sometimes you want the woodwinds to be a little louder. I happen to be a tuba.
When you first decided to put this group together, how did you let anybody know? What was your method of marketing that people, and then how far away are people that they come to you and they have recited? Kind of three-part question.
When we first started, Lorna said it was before the internet. And we actually used hieroglyphs. It was word of mouth. You know, there was no AFF or ICSA. There was no CAN. There was very few people. So there was a telephone handshake network, and that's how we got the word out.
Was it called clinic?
No, there was no clinic.
The group had been going for several years before the call.
How did you say we are a support group?
Well, we got to know, you know, just through our own experience, we had gotten to know some of the families. We got to know some, you know, John Clark was out there, Margaret was out there, but nothing was formalized in the beginning. And most of the, you know, the parents, and then once people started coming out, you know, the former cult members started to get to know each other. And they would bring other people into the group, but it was a very loose word of mouth kind of thing.
We happened to, when Lorna's brother was in his cult, we happened to stumble upon somebody that we called, who got us into the network and got us telephone numbers
network.
At that time, but there just weren't too many people. So I don't have a good answer for how we did it then. Now we have a website, but I should mention to you that we do not publish the dates of the meetings on our website. The reason being that, as we said, we have the meetings in our home, and I don't want somebody picketing our home. Mm-hmm. Not because I have a problem with picketing, it's a free country, but because I'm neighbors and I don't have to explain that. So what we do is I give out a year's worth of meetings at each meeting. We have these are the meetings that have been set up for the coming year. And then sometimes people call us and say, when is the next meeting? Or on the website, they're invited to call us. But we don't publish on our website the dates.
After we first started the group, then the Cult Awareness Network was set up, I guess, in the later 70s. And we very, nervously, maybe I'm speaking more for myself, presented our work with the group at one of those meetings. And I think that also got the word out a bit in early on.
1980.
1980
was?
June
of 1980.
Oh.
Yeah, Vanessa. Do you have any limit on the numbers, or what were your numbers generally?
Up and down, depending on how many people came that month. Another thing related to numbers was also typically after there was a conference, a national conference or some kind of workshop going, people would hear about us, and then we'd get a few more for the next meeting. There would be a lot of enthusiasm, and then it might die off. But so the numbers, we've had 30 people, maybe 35.
We've had up to 30.
Or,
Usually we have
but
maybe
that's unusual.
10 people, 10, 10 or 12.
To 12.
And we have had zero people.
Yeah. We've had.
Because it's open-ended. People are invited to come in. And as Lorna said, usually they'll come, when they first come out or first hear about it, they'll come to a bunch of meetings, 6 or 7 meetings, because they find it really helpful. And then they won't find the need for it, and they'll come back every now and then when there's an issue that has popped up. Well, I just want to mention one other thing about triggers. There's no way to avoid triggers, because people get triggered. People get triggered by many things. So we encourage people to say, "Oh, gee, that your use of that word, your use of the word commitment, has really set me off," and things like that. Okay, we understand. Let's talk about it, because we can't avoid all the words that might upset people. And I just have to tell you about the time that we had it was winter time and we had a blackout. We lost our electricity, so we had candles set up all over our house. And that was a difficult meeting. It was talking about triggering.
I was saying that there were two people that were disruptive to the group I was in. The other person that was disruptive, she and I were triggering each other, it looked like. One of the groups that she'd been exposed to that she found cult-like was AA. And in AA, they don't want you to be intellectual. They want you to just focus more on your emotions. And I tended to be very analytical in my approach and a little opinionated. And so I kept triggering her, and then she would respond to me by criticizing me, and I didn't like bossy authoritarian people, and so she was triggering me, and it's just it sometimes
conflicting.
Yeah,
and that's where a group leader, and again, it can be a peer leader, who might just be a little bit removed, might be able to say, it seems that the two of you have expectations of how people are supposed to react to each other, and you're both pulling against each other, and maybe there's a common ground here or something like that. Just a way to...
Is it okay to set up a rule such that you're free to disagree with each other, but you have to do so respectfully? You know,
just say,
you know, you don't have to agree, but please be tactful as possible or something.
Of course, no question about it. And that, again, that's what the group leader should
Let me also say, this is not a therapy group. This is a support group. So we're not involved in analyzing people's personalities in this group. So there really should be, you know, the basic rules. Not that you wouldn't have that at a therapy group as well, but, you know, really coming into the world, we have to deal with different types of personalities, and we're going to have different points of view, but we're going to have to be tactful and respectful, absolutely.
We had somebody once from a therapy cult, and his recognition of what a group was when somebody would speak and tell about a struggle, they would come off your trip, cut your bullshit, get it. And this fellow had been screened, and he was very nice, but he thought that was the norm, that's how you were supposed to act. That's what a group did. A group confronted, a group tore down, and so we intervened very quickly with that.
That was a trigger to him.
Yes.
Well, being in a group was the trigger. So he thought that's what you're supposed to do in groups.
Talk
back. You're supposed to get people off their trip.
Since you are also a therapist, and in that particular instance, leaders in a support group, from your position, when someone you realize needed more than just the support, what will be your personal approach to that particular case?
We would deal with that issue away from the group, and we might just talk with the person, and we might point out that this issue emerged in the group, and perhaps they might want to, you know, deal with that, see someone for therapy.
You'll always refer out? Will you not see the group members individually?
We sometimes see them individually. But a lot of people we don't.
But also, a lot of people come and they don't live in New Jersey, you know, so it might be hard for them to get to us too, so that wouldn't even be an issue. And we would refer to someone, you know, I might refer to Dan or some, you know, someone who would be easier for them to get to.
Because I see, I am in that position sometimes. And there is the ethical issues, being a leader in a particular group, also by profession, being a therapist, and also because you are sympathetic with the sense of reality, you will like to help that particular person,
you know,
but will be up to her or to him.
You know what, I've generally found that the people that I see for psychotherapy do not come to the group. They find other, you know, groups or other ways.
Is that under your recommendation, suggestion?
It's a preference.
I think they get more from the individual therapy. That would be my feeling. And the group, they find to be a help some, but...
Because sometimes this particular person might be comfortable dealing with you.
Sure.
Right.
Sure. Not have two separate groups. Although, if we felt there was a considerable rift in terms of needs, we could do that. But no. What happened when we first began the group is everyone was young. Everyone had just come out, and now it's unusual for us to get somebody who's just come out. It's unusual for us to get somebody who's under 30.
Mary Jo, one of the things that we found is it is so also so helpful for someone. It is so helpful for someone who is just coming out to be reassured by someone that's coming back to the group and has been out for a long time, dealt with that, tells them that they dealt with that, and this is how they dealt with that, and now they find that that issue doesn't, you know, bother them the same way anymore. You know, there's a sense of over time that things will get better or they'll change in certain ways. So the idea of having newly exited people and people who are out for a long time, first generation, we haven't even talked about how second generation people are emerging as the largest number of people in our group now. There's been a shift from first generation to people
the
who
second generation of people born and raised.
Born and raised. That's
more about them because I know that too.
Right. Well, in the early years, you know, people, cults had just come on the scene in the late 60s. We were seeing the people coming out of these early groups, and people who stayed in those groups had children, and now those children are, you know, as you guys all know, those children are young adults. They're leaving their groups, and so that's a big group of exodus.
So they come out, whereas the first generation people came out, came back to a family, a family that often had its own problems, of course, but was a family that welcomed them back. Second generation people often are leaving their family. So they leave with a different group, different needs. They sometimes have social service needs. There's a organization that was just announced at the conference today that's starting in California to case manage people that have come out, and I think that would deal with a lot of second generation people. By case manager means helping them to get housing, helping them to get insurance, helping them to get jobs, helping them to get therapy. You know, just facilitating getting them to people that can help.
One of the interesting things that has come out of our group now is that first generation people who've had children growing up in the group and second generation people who have left their families to come out have an opportunity to talk with one another in the group. And we find that that can be so valuable because it really helps them so much see the other one's point of view.
In our last meeting, we had two people, one of whom had rejected her son on the advice of the cult leaders, had cut off ties with her son. Now she's left the group. The son wants to have nothing to do with her, and she's, as you can imagine, just.
But we should say he exited the group as a teenager.
That's why she rejected him. I didn't make that clear.
He left the group.
So she was told to cut off ties with him. Now that she's recognized what happened and she left, she wants to establish ties with him, and he wants to have nothing to do with her. And also in the group, we had a young woman from the same group who left. Her parents are still involved, and she's furious with her parents for being non-nurturing and non-understanding. But the two of them were able to bond. The younger woman was able to reach out to the mother and to say, I understand, and it's difficult, and you didn't do it based on your rejection of your son, but based on your loyalty to the group. It was tender.
It was so incredible how it helps people understand the other one's point of view. You have compassion for everyone sitting there, and they're from varied experiences. And, you know, so that is a wonderful opportunity.
The friends out to support
was asking about peer support groups. She pointed out that there's a difference between the therapy group, which we would feel should be run by a trained professional, and a support group. And can a support group be run by a non-professional? And the answer is, of course, absolutely. There's plenty of peer support groups. The only thing, again, that I recommend in the peer support group is that you have a leader who's designated, and that you do screening.
I was interested to know as far as, like, it sounds like your group is open to all sorts of ex-cult members, and I'm just wondering if it's an advantage or disadvantage to have a group that's narrower, you know, like maybe just an ex-Mooney group or an ex-Scientology group, or is it just kind of, do you find...
I think that might be useful in its own way, but for us, the basic idea that the same techniques, the same manipulation goes on across the board, demystifies every experience that they've had. You know, because I think if people are coming in, if they remain with the same group of people, maybe some of those experiences are still seen as spiritual, magical in some way.
Unique. It's amazing how many times people have said, I can't believe that the same thing. I also had the fantasy that someone was going to break into the room and shoot our leader, and I would take a bullet and die a martyr. I for my therapy cult leader, and I for my religious cult leader, and I for my political leader. But I want to mention that on occasion we get calls from some member of a group that has just broken up, a cult that has just broken up, and people are hanging out there. And in that case, we have some meetings of the former members of that group alone to help them, you know, because that then they're in acute crisis and they really need that help.
But is that different? Is it somehow have a different feel?
Oh yeah, it's more. It would be, you know, it would be maybe a longer period of time, and there would be, the focus would be more on an very educational process, helping them, you know, with the basic ideas
although feelings are certainly a part of it, there what we try to do is to help them to sort out what happened to them and what they're going through. And there we're much more active in a group like that.
Yeah.
Are there times, over the years, it must have been, when there's only one of you there, and does that adversely or affect the group? Is, you know, and when there's only one of you, is it different for you? One of you who's leading the group? I don't think so.
It's different, yes, but I don't think it adversely affects the group.
No.
We're both kind of.
And that's pretty rare. Because if we have it at our home on a Saturday night, so we make sure not to schedule anything that Saturday night, and it's at our home. So it's pretty easy, unless something comes up that we absolutely have, you know, family situation, you know, something, or we're both there.
I know you have your own solution that you describe, but I'm curious if just from what you've learned about other support groups around the country, if you can say a little bit more about the solutions people have had to, especially today, to publicity and to getting a meeting space. You know, because they're very practical problems that face setting up a support group. You can't get very far unless you can advertise it somehow and have a place to meet, and homes, you know, may or may not be, you know, an easy solution.
I think we should deflect that to the group. People have their experiences.
My husband and I started a support group this past January. And we read, we emailed Bill and Lorna and asked them how they did theirs, and we tried to gather as much information off the internet as we could. And then we said, okay, well, how are we going to do this? And then we thought, well, how are we going to get the word out? You know, how do people know? Because, so we started doing, and we just kind of had to make it up. Of course, advertising on the website. We advertised a lot locally. We live in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, so we advertised in some of the alternative magazines and asked people at different websites
that cultivators websites to post something about it. And we get a lot of calls. We get we do the screening too. We meet with them, and we've had to screen some people out. It just did not seem appropriate. They were not going to get something out of it, or they were going to be disruptive to the group. I think about this one lady who had been out of her cult for like 15 years. Sees a therapist a couple of times a week and has been doing that for years and years and years. And she lived 5 hours away from us. And I just thought, and she called and called and called, so I was kind of thinking, she might have too many needs for us to be able to handle this corporate. So we kind of freaked her out. We told her that, you know, someplace else would probably be better for her than our group. But it's been amazing. We are averaging about 10 people up. Support group meetings. We meet once a month like the Goldbergs do. And we got some space initially from a church, a parish hall, and it was free space, so couldn't beat that. But then there was some conflict, so we had it in our home a couple of times. And the people really seemed to like it in our home. They were able to interact more with each other, more casual. They just had more of a social time too, more in there. It's been an amazing experience, very, very rewarding to us, and the people have said it's been very rewarding to them. We've had people that have just come out maybe a year, and there's other ones that have been out 10 years, and they will say things like, it is so encouraging for us to see you people that have been out for 10 years, it's, you know, that there is light at the end of the tunnel.
And that, you know, I always say that it's a learning path for us. I mean, just the privilege of every month.
Yeah.
Just imagine, and I know you're experiencing it now. You sit there, the dynamic is different, the people are different, some of the same people. You know, so much of what we've learned by just sitting there listening, you know, over the years. It's amazing. And to see people, you know, who we saw years ago come to a group and then, you know, come back maybe 5 years later bringing someone or with a particular issue and seeing how they've grown and how helpful they are to the other members of the group. I mean, you experience, I think, some of that at these conferences, too. I know you do. It's just...
We've had more than a few times that we've been contacted by a young adult who just left his cult. His parents are still in, and he's looking for help. We've met with him a few times, and, or her. They moved on, and then 5 years later, I get a call from two middle-aged people who've come out, and I'm talking to them, and their story is sounding familiar. And then the penny drops, and I say,
I
had a question. My background is inpatient psychiatric care, so my thoughts were going to crisis and the phone call about I need to meet with you now. I mean, like yesterday, let's get together. How do you handle, or what do you teach people? Should they be triggered, go home, feel like they're going to lose it? You can't be given your phone number. Wondering how do you responsibly address the issue that you may feel this way, and here's what you do.
We have not had bad experiences. We haven't had very many bad experiences in terms of folks taking advantage of us in terms of that. Usually when people call and we call back, and if they're in a minor crisis, we can help them through, and if somebody's in a major crisis, we suggest that they get to a hospital.
So you are the reference then, if somebody has trouble, or do they know that they
if
can
we have a
trigger?
Sense that somebody is in a really difficult state, you know, we do suggest that they go for therapy. You know,
I think I meant more immediate.
Yeah, but if they're having
or to an emergency room. Acute psychiatric.
Yeah,
distress.
But that is not such a common occurrence.
But as lay people leading a group, it would be good to familiarize yourself with
the local hospital.
The local
right,
emergency
right.
situation.
Hotlines.
Sure.
Hotlines and
right.
so on. Just so you have that in your pocket, I would
right.
think.
That's right.
Yeah, a lot of you know, self-help groups, like 12-step groups, like they have, you know, like their 12 steps they kind of use as a foundation, as tools. I was just wondering what sort of resources like you would have for all the common types of issues. There must be certain sort of common issues that come up from people trying to heal them.
Well, generally, we, in our individual meeting, that we might suggest articles and books and the like to read for that kind of information. We don't usually do that in our group. Our group is a more free-flowing kind of thing. Although, and again, some folks that are not as comfortable in leading groups might want to use a 12-step program or the concept of this is our theme tonight.
It's not our
way.
You know, and again, through the course of the group, a lot of the members will bring up, you know, this book was very useful to me
right.
in that situation. I mean, you know, the members helping, the focus is on they're really helping themselves with literature. I should also say that with the screening evaluation interview, if we meet people at conferences and we get a sense of them, they don't have to go through the screening process because they've already, you could consider their experience going through the conference. You know, we really, in just talking with them, we learn that they really do have an understanding of what they've been through. So that people don't always have to be screened.
Screened formally by us.
Right.
The screening, how do you actually do it, the screening? At what point?
We meet with the individual. I usually say, well, our next group meeting is such and such a date. We want to meet with you beforehand. There's a screening intake meeting that we have. So I set up a time.
You have a form?
It's not a form. We just meet. Our offices are in our home, and the group also meets in our home. So we just have them come to our office, and one of us sometimes the day before the
so it's one-on-one.
One-on-one screening.
Let me
right.
also say, because people might be interested in this, in terms of fee, you know, when we originally set up the group, we didn't charge a fee for the group. The fee was, coming was free. And what we decided to do was establish a fee for the screening process. The screening process, we would be meeting people, let's say, for an hour and a half to 2 hours, and that was our time, our office time, and we would charge a fee, and they would pay our regular fee for two sessions, or if they couldn't, there was a sliding scale for people, because we didn't want the fee to exclude anyone from coming to us. But the way we originally established it, there is no fee, but for the group. But that isn't necessarily what other people should do. It's just something we...
No, I wouldn't, as someone without a credential, I wouldn't feel comfortable charging anything for peer support.
Well, sometimes people will kick in for refreshments.
Yeah, kicking in for refreshments, I can see that.
Sure.
That's making it clear that the money is not for me.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to get back to the question that Gal brought up about hospitalization. And one of my concerns is that there are people who sound crazy because of the groups that they've been in. And anyone who doesn't know about this stuff would assume, make the assumption. And that needs to be addressed. As you know, if you're really feeling unsafe,
yes.
you might want to go there. I would be willing to meet with you, you know, tomorrow or something like that, and have them then talk to someone who's really knowledgeable. So it's so that if you can't deal with it, you at least be able to put them there. But I think people need to know that can happen, and it can happen more often than people may realize.
And we have to be comfortable with our own limitations. And certainly, Lorna and I, refer, if we feel the person needs medication, we refer to doctors.
And we try as best we can to refer to people that understand cults, because you're bringing up an important issue that people come into the group often, you know, talk about how people do think they're crazy and delusional with the ideas that they have, which were cult-induced. And, you know, how wonderful it is to be in a place where people have an understanding that these were ideas in their head from the cult.
Patricia?
Yeah, couple of things. One is just for people who may be considering doing the group. The young man that leads the group that I'm associated with, they actually meet at my house during the summer, but they meet at a school just for people who are anti-church or uncomfortable with going to someone's home, because there's a lot of cults that met in homes. So they meet at a local public school, which allows them to have a room for free. And then the other thing that he did that I think was a good choice is Lois Lamoda is nearby. And so she's our backup for people who may have some emotional meltdowns or whatever. She's committed to being available to someone, knowing that it is a peer-led group, but so that we're fortunate that we have somebody that person can be referred to in the event they do need somebody to talk to, because all of us are ex-cult members and we're not therapists, and so, you know, that's not the goal. I just thought two things. One, yes, the hospital, I think, is important, but also, you know, fortunately, you know therapists, but to have that maybe available. And David's really great about handing out the rules at every meeting. These are the things we abide by.
Yeah, and let me say that in the early years, people came to our group from all over. I mean, you know, because there weren't these other groups. And actually, in the early years, people camped out in or they'd bring sleeping bags, and they would be in our living room staying over, you know, because they had come from other places. There was nothing, you know, Washington, D.C., or wherever they were from, and that's changed because there are other resources.
I run an ex-member group in London, so I'm partly telling you just so that you know. So if you know of anybody who might be interested, we meet every 2 months because I don't live in London, so it's kind of structured differently. And people do pay, and they know up front that they pay, and yes, we set the dates. And we tend to do it in a more structured way, that there's what seems to work for us is having a subject interesting. And the times we haven't had a subject, or it's been a bit waffly, it hasn't worked as well. It's strange that. But yeah, it's great. I love it. And I'd love to do it more often, really, but I have to travel to London. I don't make any money out of it, but the money just about covers the the trip and that sort of thing. And I wanted to ask a question about supervision, because I have supervision for the group. So I'm a trained therapist, so I kind of feel, you know, I like that support. Do you put it into that field of supervision? Do you have supervision for the running of the group? Like you have therapists? Have supervision?
Well,
this is a support group, not a therapy.
This isn't a therapy group.
Yes.
And,
but I still have mine isn't a therapy group, but I still have supervision on it.
I'm in psychoanalytic training.
Yeah.
And I have a control analyst who I see weekly.
Let me also that one of the nice things about, there are a lot of nice things about having the group with Bill, but you know, after the group, we also have peer supervision,
right,
where the two, if things come up, you know, we can talk it over and figure it out, the two of us together, which is one, you know, it's a nice thing to have two people involved with the group.
Yeah, I said last week, did you notice that so-and-so just slipped out? She didn't say goodbye at the end of the group. She didn't talk to anyone. anybody, she might be upset. Lorna called
her. I called her. I just
she might
called.
Not have noticed.
I said, you know, I'm just checking in. I noticed that you just slipped out. You know, how are things?
You raised the point that, you know, it's good to know who the network of people leading these groups are, because if you have a problem in your group, you can call Bill and Lorna, for example.
Oh,
you can call, Julie in the UK and just run it by informal supervision.
That's one of the things that's great about this conference, is I'm in Los Angeles, so I, through these conferences, have been able to connect with other therapists in Los Angeles. And whenever, doing therapy or support groups, I come across something that's, seems out of my league, I can just always call and say, what's your perspective? I was going to say something too about the crisis, issue. I think that, I'm a licensed therapist, so there's a whole set of requirements, that I need to follow in terms of assessing for crisis and, whether or not, the level of danger and all that stuff. But somebody who is, not a therapist doesn't have that training, and it would be good, like you were suggesting, to have one therapist that you could, refer to in terms of just therapy, and also a crisis hotline phone number to either give to the person to call or sit with the person and make a call with them. And then it's those professionals who can make the determination about hospitalization and the need for it.
Yes, exactly.
I really agree with you about the distinction between a support group and a therapy group. I mean, I'm interested in starting a support group, but I'm not a therapist, I'm not interested in giving therapy, and when I was in another support group that somebody else led, I was not in there for the purpose of therapy, I just really wanted to talk to other people who did the same thing. But also, if I were going to start my own group, there is a therapist locally whom I know who is a former cult member and is familiar with the issues. I also have a friend who's a psychiatric nurse, who works at a hospital who could handle crisis situations. So I feel really secure about that.
Yes.
So I'm feeling more confident that, gee, I really could do this.
Yeah, sure. And if you sense that someone in the group is trying to analyze someone else, just say, this is not a therapy. You just remind them that it's a support group.
Yeah, and then, it's appropriate to analyze experiences and cult dynamics,
but not
appropriate to analyze
personalities.
Exactly, yeah. And not in this setting.
Yes. Yeah.
Have you ever permitted people who were not ex-cultists to attend the meeting? So it could be, for example, an ex-cultist wants to come with a boyfriend or a girlfriend or something like that, or you have all sorts of different circumstances that wind up. And I was just curious, how you address that.
That's a good question.
Our rule is that the group is for former cult members. However, there are occasions when somebody first comes out, they're really nervous, they want to have
their
friend with them, and what we'll do then is to open it up to the group. So-and-so is asked to have their sister sit in. It's perfectly all right for you folks to say you're not comfortable with it. If you are, is it okay? I think every time we've done that, people have said it's okay, except once. Somebody said, no, I really wouldn't feel comfortable. No question about it. We've asked that person to go into the office and read during the time.
And
usually people are okay.
Sometimes when someone has come with a parent, we've asked the parent to sit in another room, or to go to a movie.
In terms of parents, it's a different dynamic. And parents, I don't throw it up to the group. I say it's really for former cult members. But if it's a peer that they brought with them for support, then we'll ask them.
5 more minutes.
Thank you.
Question is, our exposure to this world is simply because we're family members, parents of someone that's in the cult. Is that all this is brand new, and I've never heard of support system. So you all have been doing this a long time. Is there like a network out there? And you say there's support groups all over the country, and I hear from Los Angeles, London,
How do you find it? Carol Giambalvo. Sitting at the desk right there, because that's where she always is the head of Refocus. Refocus is the national support organization for support groups. And Carol knows where everyone is and who the leaders are.
That's awesome.
And she has it on her website.
Support groups out there for
families. Yes.
Oh, support groups
for families.
Yes, on the website.
Absolutely. Well, in New York, at the Jewish board, there is that long
support groups.
There aren't as many support groups for families, unfortunately.
Your area is where?
We're in Southern Ohio, and outside of our conversation that we have with people, no one even we never even heard of the call until
How close are you to Athens?
Well, we know Wellspring, but Wellspring is we've been to Wellspring. It's a private place, and it's not like signed up on someone's home. I see this as a professional institution, Wellspring is, versus what I see this being more of an informal gathering of I see it as two different institutions.
Yes.
I know Wellspring, and we've met the people who've actually been there before, but I don't see that as this.
Okay, two more questions, then we're going to...
Other suggestion. There's a group. There are a group of self-help clearinghouses or self-help. A group that organizes and helps self-help groups. And there's the big ones that I can think of are in California, Michigan, and New York, and Connecticut. And I'm sure there are others, but I just can't remember where they are. And they're for all kinds of self-help support groups, whether it's people whose parents have Alzheimer's or breast cancer survivors or whatever, and their mission is to support peer support groups. They have a lot of resources. They are terrific about helping you organize, and they list the group that you're providing in their handbook or on their website or whatever. And if you have one of those in your area, it may take a little bit of digging to find them. They're a wonderful way to plug in. We used to actually in New York many years ago, the old New York CAN used to share our office with the New York support group, and we were part of that organization. So that is another way to get references, but it's also another way to get a lot of support for running your group. And it might be something just to keep in the back of your minds.
How much time do you allow for a support group meeting?
Our group meets for 2.5 hours. We meet from 7:30 to 10. But that's flexible.
Oh, 9:30.
Somebody had mentioned about children and parents, and what occurred to me, what about younger children, under 18, minors? Maybe you ever run into, should their parents want to be there with them?
We've actually never had a minor, I think, in our group, so it hasn't come up. Yeah. But I think if we were to...
Like us do a waiver?
I don't know. We haven't come across it, so we haven't really dealt
with it. I was in a support group where a minor came, but it was in the circumstance where his parents were also former members.
Oh.
So
right.
It was the whole family.
Let me end, because I think our time is up. I want to end with a story of a man is walking through an area, and he falls into a hole, and he yells, "Help, help, I'm in a hole!" And a lawyer comes along and says, "What happened?" He says, "I fell into a hole." The lawyer says, "I'll sue this son of a bitch that dug this hole." And he walks on. And then a clergyman comes along and he says, "What happened?" He says, "I fell into a hole." And the clergyman says, "I'll pray for you." And he walks on. And then a friend walks by. And he says, "What happened?" He says, "I fell into a hole." And the friend jumps down into the hole. And the guy says, "Well, what did you do that for? Now we're both in the hole." And the friend says, "Yeah, but I fell into this hole yesterday, and I know how to get out."